Well, a warm welcome to today's talk, Monday the 13th of March. Now, I'm looking at a new study today from Canada, just published in March 2023, and it shows that people that take vitamin D supplement get about a 40% protection against dementia. Now, a few weeks ago, we looked at people taking vitamin D supplement get about a 15 to 18% protection against people that have pre-diabetes, developing diabetes, and that accounts for, that applies to about over 90 million people in the United States, so a huge difference. And here we're seeing that there's a 40% protective effect in this study against developing dementia, particularly Alzheimer's disease. And people that are likely to get diabetes are likely to get dementia, so it just seems to make perfect sense to give these people extra vitamin D. Now, here's this study here. So the blue line is people that had vitamin D, and the green line is people that didn't have vitamin D. And these are people that survived without getting dementia. So we see a clear difference. And the study was done over 10 years. So we see that people that had no vitamin D, fewer of them survived without developing dementia. So it's an absolutely huge effect from what is essentially an interventional study. So let's look at it now. Vitamin D supplementation, and we'll look at some of these other things in a minute. A diagnosis and assessment and disease monitoring journal, peer-reviewed, Alzheimer's Society of Canada, published from Alberta. Now, there's been known associations in the past with vitamin D and dementia. In other words, people with low vitamin D levels have known to be getting more dementia, but it wasn't known whether it was a correlation or whether it was causal. This shows that it's very likely to be a causal correlation, that giving vitamin D protects against dementia. So the role of supplementation was unclear, but this does clarify. It's a prospective study, and as we say, it's longitudinal, so it goes on for 10 years. Now, that's a really good study length, and we can see the gap is increasing. The protective effect of vitamin D is increasing over the 10-year period. Now, there was 12,388 patients dementia-free at the start of the study, so pretty good number. 12,388 from the National Alzheimer's Coordinating Centre sorted out that in Canada. So people that took vitamin D were called D positive, and people that didn't take vitamin D were called D negative. And they wanted to see what the difference was over this longitudinal period. And as we noticed, as time went on, the benefit just seemed to carry on increasing. So we've got a benefit there after what? That's about after about a year. So taking vitamin D for about a year, and then the gap just goes on increasing, with fewer and fewer people surviving here without dementia as time goes on. The p-value there is very significant. P equals 0.0001. So very likely to, unlikely to have arisen by chance. And the average age in entering the study was 71 years. So again, people that are at risk of diabetes as well as dementia could benefit from this. Mild cognitive impairment and depression were both more common in the D negative group compared to the D positive group. In other words, people taking vitamin D had less mild cognitive impairment and less depression, consistent with data that we looked at from Ireland a few months ago or last year, whenever it was. The Irish government advising supplementation to improve mood over winter, as depression is so common, especially in winter time, but it's common anyway. Now, they did adjust in this study for age, sex, education, race, cognitive diagnosis, depression, and this is apolipoprotein. Now, this is a gene, and people that have this gene, it's known, are more likely to get dementia. So people have one copy of this gene. If they're heterozygous, that's about 25% of us. People have two copies of this gene, that's about 3% of us, are more prone to dementia. Of course, people with two copies of the gene are more prone to dementia, much more prone to dementia. But that they took that into account. If you want to know if you have that gene or not, you can get a genetic test for that. You can see your doctor and get a genetic test for it if you'll do it. If you live in the UK, I don't think you've got any chance of getting it on the NHS, but you can always ask if you wanted to know, if you're worried about family history. And they looked at other covariates. These are the covariates that here that we're talking about. Now, the results across all formulations. Now, some people were given vitamin D3. Some people were given D2. And some people were taking D3 plus calcium. It's not a combination I like particularly, but a lot of doctors still give it. Probably better to give K2, but that's what's often done. So that's what they looked at. Were people getting D3 and calcium. Now, vitamin D exposure was associated with significantly longer dementia-free periods of time. So there's no question that the vitamin D here was working really quite dramatically well to prevent the development of dementia. Longer survival, dementia-free time. Lower dementia incident rate than no exposure. So the vitamin D was clearly protecting. Now, hazard ratio was 0.6. Really very, very impressive. And the researchers were 95% sure it was between 0.55 and 0.65. So like very, very impressive, almost half as likely. It's a 40% reduction. Dementia exposure was associated with a 40% lower dementia incidence versus no exposure. So vitamin D, 40% less cases of dementia. The authorities need to act on this. They really do, because this is a massive benefit that we are seeing. And indeed, we have been predicting for some time on this channel, it has to be said, for this and other conditions. The reason for it is we just don't make it in northern latitudes in winter. Nearly all the vitamin D is made from the skin. And we don't get exposed to the sun over winter. It's pretty obvious, really. And even in summer, we're often working in call centres or working in hospitals or lecturing inside classrooms or sitting inside classrooms where we don't get exposed to the sun anything like as much as we would like. So we simply don't make the vitamin D from the sunshine. Now, as I've said, this study went on for 10 years, so it was a longitudinal study. And what they actually found is they presented the results in different ways, but over 10 years of follow-up, 12,388 people in the study, what they found is that starting at the age of, as we said, the average age of 71, so following up to the average age of 81 years, they found that of the 12,388, 2,696 participants developed dementia. Amongst those that developed dementia, 2,017, that's 74%, had no exposure to vitamin D. So they did not, they were the D negative group. They didn't have any vitamin D. Of the patients that did have vitamin D, 679, that's 25%, developed dementia. So we see that the vast majority of the people, 78% of the people that developed dementia, did not have vitamin D. 25% of the people that developed dementia did have vitamin D, just another way to look at the results, but still pretty impressive protective effect. Or just one other way to look at it, exposure to vitamin D was associated with significantly high dementia-free period. 5-year survival with no dementia for vitamin D negative people not taking vitamin D, only 68.4 survived unscathed without dementia. Whereas for people taking vitamin D, 83.6 survive for 5 years unscathed by dementia. It's a big difference. Now, the effect of vitamin D did vary. So vitamin D effect was significantly greater in females versus males. So for some reason, vitamin D was more protective in women. Hard to say why. Is it that women have less exposure outside than men, perhaps? Men have more vitamin D from the sun. Don't know, the study doesn't tell us, but interesting. But quite why that was, we don't know, but interesting. Vitamin D effects were significantly greater in people with normal cognition at the start versus people with mild cognitive impairment at the start. So people that were normal at the age of 71, when the average age of this study started, got even more benefit. So people without cognitive impairment getting more protection from vitamin D. Again, not clear why, but that's what the study shows. Vitamin D effects were significantly greater in this apolipoprotein E4 non-carriers versus carriers. Vitamin D effects were less significant in apolipoprotein carriers. In other words, if people carry this gene, which predisposes them to dementia, the vitamin D gives them less benefit. If people do not carry this gene, which predisposes to dementia, then people get more benefit. But only 3% of the population have got two copies of that gene. 25% have got one copy, but the people with 25%, the 25% of the population with one copy of the gene, of course, have much less risk than those with two copies of the gene. Now, why vitamin D is not as effective in people that carry this gene is not clear. It could be they need higher doses of vitamin D because the gene is affecting vitamin D metabolism in some way, or it could be that the effects of the gene simply override any benefits from the vitamin D. But still, for the vast majority, for 97% of us who don't have two copies of this gene, the protective effects of vitamin D are high. The people with this gene got some protection, just not as much. So it's still a benefit. So to quote the authors, vitamin D has potential for dementia prevention, especially in high-risk strata. And the vitamin D deficiency worldwide, the prevalence is up to 1 billion people. So if you think about it, 40% of that is 400 million people. 400 million cases of dementia could be potentially protected. We need to be measuring people's vitamin D levels and titrating them up. Now, my doctor won't measure my vitamin D levels, unfortunately. So what I'm doing, personally, I'm taking 4,000 international units of vitamin D a day, of D3 a day. That's what I take. 4,000 international units of D3. Now that equals 100. It's the same as saying 100 micrograms of D3 a day is what I'm taking. And I also take 100 micrograms of vitamin K2 with that. So that's what I'm taking a day, 100 of D3 and 100 of K2, because we want the calcium to go into the right places. This will put the calcium into the bones instead of into the tissues. 100 micrograms of vitamin D3 is the same as 4,000 international units. It's a pity we measure it in two ways, but we do. That's what I'm taking over winter in the north of England. Can't tell you what to do. I'm not your doctor, but that's what I'm taking personally. Now, it's always nice to know there's a mechanism of action as well. So, for example, Austin Bradford Hill and Richard Doll discovered that smoking caused lung cancer from epidemiological studies. It was only after that, when people in the laboratory looked and they found out the way that the tar and other chemicals in the cigarettes were having a carcinogenic effect on the chromosomes in the lung lining. So but that just reinforces the effect. But there are clear mechanisms of action here. Vitamin D is known to participate in the clearance of this amyloid protein. Now, this amyloid protein actually starts clogging the brain up, unfortunately. So if we think about a brain, a brain's kind of like a boxing glove, isn't it? There's a brain, very vaguely. This amyloid protein will start clogging the brain up like that, and that's one of the hallmarks of Alzheimer's disease. So the vitamin D helps the clearance; it takes this amyloid protein out of the brain, which is good. And may provide neuroprotection against A-beta-induced tau hyperphosphorylation. Don't worry about the big words. What this is, if we think about the smaller scale, if we think about the nerve cells in the brain connected by fibres, like this, all over the brain, 100,000 million nerve cells in the brain, then this tau protein, what the tau does, is the tau forms these neurofibril tangles. So you get these little tangly bits here, which is one of the characteristics. So they're the kind of pathologies that we get, these tau neurofibril tangles, and we get these amyloid deposits. And it's plausible that the vitamin D prevents both of those. And cholecalciferol, that's D3, may be more protective than ergocalciferol, which is D2. So it looks like D3 is the one to take, which is the one that's made in the skin normally, of course. So pretty impressive protection there against dementia. This really does need to be done. This is cheap, it's natural, it doesn't cost anything, We're not paying thousands of dollars per year to a pharmaceutical company. Vitamin D, at the moment, my tubs of vitamin D, these are currently, I think, £1.50 from local supermarkets, which is under $2. So that's the way to go. Clever pharmaceutical interventions aren't necessary. We just need to compensate for our sun-avoiding lifestyles because, of course, human beings were originally tropical, where vitamin D from the sun wasn't a problem. Now, I just want to finish with a clip from our community health project in Uganda. We're in the process of giving out large amounts of mosquito nets. So far, we've bought 1,500 mosquito nets. We're trying to collect data to look at the efficacy of this so we can roll this out as a model in other parts of the country. We know it's going to prevent malaria, but we're trying to prove it as we go along. But so far, we've given 1,500 mosquito nets out, partly due to this channel and partly due to your buy me a coffee money, which I'll put a link below if anyone wants to contribute to that. But let's look at the mosquito net distribution in Uganda here. So there we are. That was a mosquito net distribution. I don't know what that lady was saying about her teeth, but she was certainly pleased to have been being bitten by mosquitoes for the last 60 or 65 years or whatever it was. I'm sure she's very pleased and not to. So as well as other things, we're giving out one of these 1,500 mosquito nets. We'll try and collect the data and see how many cases of malaria and other insect diseases that prevents. So this is what healthcare is all about, of course. It's helping individuals. And I'll put the link if you want to see more from that work in Uganda on the description. But for now, thank you for watching, and try and encourage all our health authorities to test everyone's vitamin D level, to titrate it up to the right amount, preventing pre-diabetics becoming diabetic, preventing non-demented people becoming dementing. This is a complete no-brainer that we should be doing now, but unfortunately we are not. Let's hope it's not because we can't make any money out of vitamin D. Let's hope that's not the reason. So that's what we need to start doing. Thank you for watching.